our final speaker is actually from the ATT&CK team. It's our ATT&CK for ICS lead, Otis Alexander.
Thank you, Adam. So what I'll do is I'll quickly give an update on ATT&CK for ICS. I'll let you know what we kind of got accomplished last year and what's on the horizon. So this is our press release when we released ATT&CK. It's kind of surreal looking at this because I have a hard time believing that this was released this year. It seems like 2 years ago. But nonetheless, January 7th, 2020, we released ATT&CK for ICS, and it's a knowledge base that explains adversary behavior against industrial control systems. So given the short amount of time, around 11 months, we've gotten a lot of attention around ATT&CK for ICS from different entities in the ICS community. And we couldn't fit everybody on this slide, but what I want to say is thank you to everybody who talks about how they use ATT&CK for ICS and why it's important to the community. So in the first blog post I released upon release of ATT&CK for ICS, I kind of talked about what were some of our short-term goals in terms of ATT&CK for ICS. What do we want to add to it? And one of the big things I talked about was, you know, the insecure by design nature of a lot of the components and networks and the like in the industrial control system. So we thought it would be prudent to first think about the mitigations that are associated with the adversary behavior and the techniques. So our approach to that was to use ATT&CK for enterprise and see what mitigations they had, how they applied to the techniques that we've put into ATT&CK for ICS, and then kind of figure out where the gaps were. And we found some gaps, and that ended up in us creating 17 new mitigations that really focus on industrial control systems. So where applicable, each mitigation has a mapping to IEC 62443 and NIST 853 in the info box of the mitigation. So you can use that to kind of cross-reference security controls. And what we really try to do is to think low level. What do we think would most benefit embedded controllers as well as the networks? But we really had a focus on embedded controllers, protecting the operational and management interfaces there. And from an asset owner operator perspective, you may say, hey, I can't do anything there. It'll mess up my certifications, and you're most likely correct. And we just want everybody to understand that there's multiple stakeholders we're talking to in terms of these mitigations. So asset owners, operators, integrators, device vendors, security vendors, they all have their part in kind of implementing these mitigations. So some other very exciting news is the STIX and Navigator integration. We got a lot of asks about, you know, when will we be integrating these tools, and would they be able to use these and leverage them? So as of ATT&CK version 8, we released ATT&CK for ICS and STIX. So now you can ingest it in your tools. You can use it more programmatically. And then also some good news is with the new version of ATT&CK Navigator, you're now able to pick ICS as a domain. So now you can look, use it in visualizations and anything else you want to do with Navigator there. So we're moving towards more integration, and we hope that you enjoy using these tools with ATT&CK for ICS. So those are some of the highlights from last year. What's on the horizon for us? Well, one thing we really want to do is focus on data sources this year. So these are really important to us. Maintaining visibility into ICS networks is kind of in its infancy. It's essential, however, for quickly detecting and remediating cyber threats. So understanding the various data sources ahead of time before something happens is a key endeavor to this mission. While network traffic is really popular, it's king right now. You see a lot of passive network detection solutions coming out. There are other valuable data sources that are often overlooked, and some examples are here, embedded device logs. So we do see some companies doing some active polling. various application logs associated with engineering applications or HMIs and the like, and then operational databases such as work order databases, historians, and the like. So there's a lot of options out there. And the way we're really thinking about this is, what do these data sources provide us at a high level? And what is attached to these high level categories? So some things that we're looking at are process information. So various events that can clue you on to command execution if you miss it over the network, or you need some way to corroborate what you see over the network. Also, asset management is very important. So condition-based monitoring, predictive maintenance, how is your equipment running? Is there any problems there? And does that link up with other events that you've seen? Or even things like work order databases. So a program download isn't necessarily bad, but did the program download happen when it was supposed to happen? So this is something that we're really excited about getting into ATT&CK for ICS and really refining what we have so far. And last but not least, we want to include the ICS attacks in enterprise ATT&CK. So one of the key tasks that we have is mapping these attacks to enterprise techniques. So you can see here, these are some attacks that we are focusing on right now: Stuxnet, Ukraine 2015, and Destroyer and Trident. And we're really responding to what we've heard from industry, and kind of what we've always said is you kind of need to use these two knowledge bases together, because adversaries don't respect theoretical boundaries. And it's important to have a deep understanding of how they leverage IT platforms to access and impact ICS. So we really want this to help explain the full gamut of adversary behavior. And as always, we need your help. This is a community effort. So we always are curious about how we can improve ATT&CK for ICS. Things that we're doing are how are you using it? So for instance, the mitigations, are you currently using them? We've heard some great stories from device vendors so far. And do you have any opinions about the direction that we're taking, specifically in terms of our data source focus? How would you do it? What do you think is important there? So that's all I have. Thank you. Always feel free to reach out. Let us know if you have any questions.
Yeah, and Otis should be available for questions in Slack. I've got one set up for him. Thank you again for joining us today.